When Katrina hit and the levees broke, many predicted the death of a great American city. But 5 years later, instead of an obituary, we're writing a new chapter.
Something new is going to happen.
We have survived and endured.
Let's stop thinking about the city we were and start dreaming about the city we want to become.
It's a region rebuilt with the help of compassionate strangers from around the world. Find out if they're still coming to lend a hand. Hear from some of the many heroes who saved thousands of lives after the storm.
It was surprising to me how many people stayed behind.
And meet the warriors still fighting for their community.
We don't want to be a tourist attraction. We want to be restored.
Tonight, a reality check.
People come back here and they say, you still look like this 5 years later?
But the journey continues towards a better New Orleans.
It is a special place.
At a crossroads, 5 years after Katrina. This is the London Avenue Canal levee, which failed on August 29, 2005, allowing water to pour into the surrounding neighborhoods. But the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers has built a massive pumping station, both to funnel water into Lake Pontchartrain and block storm surge. That's just one of the big changes we've seen in the past 5 years. During this next hour, we'll look at the milestones and challenges in a post-Katrina New Orleans. Are we where we thought we'd be 5 years ago? And how far do we have to go? Let's start with the people. 66 of New Orleans' 73 neighborhoods have recovered, more than half of their pre-Katrina population. Tonight, we'll take a look at three areas hit hardest by flooding. We begin in Lakeview, where WDSU News reporter Travis Mackle found you can see progress nearly everywhere you look.
Just off Harrison Avenue, in the heart of Lakeview, is where Mike Maples wants to be.
So we built a new home.
Maple's old home was actually in the exact same spot, but it completely flooded when Hurricane Katrina hit 5 years ago, forcing him to tear it down.
The water, if it hit again today for the same amount of water, it would probably come up to about right here.
Mike's wife knew their house was gone right when the levees broke.
Once I saw the picture on West End of the subdivision and on the neutral ground, I knew our house was, you know, under lots of water.
The images from summer 2005 at West End are chilling.
That's where we are, West End exit off the interstate, headed west.
Lakeview was one of the hardest areas hit by Katrina, and nearly 3 weeks after the hurricane, this area has still not recovered. 2 to 3 feet of standing water are still sitting on Harrison Avenue.
But how the times have changed.
We feel that the progress is remarkable.
Glenn Stout heads up the Lakeview Civic Improvement Association.
I don't think there was ever a question in anyone's mind past day one, two, or maybe 17 once the water receded that Lakeview was coming back.
About 4,500 homes have been rebuilt in Lakeview. There were roughly 7,300 prior to the storm, meaning there are still some empty lots here and there.
It's still empty. Something new is going to happen, and that's the interesting and challenging part of it.
And it's not just homeowners who've returned to Lakeview. The Lakeview Civic Improvement Association tells us that since Katrina hit this area 5 years ago, more than 80 businesses have reopened.
It's unbelievable, the neighborhood support, how everybody just comes to eat. People in Lakeview love to eat out.
Well, businesses follow the population.
And the population is rising.
But New Orleans is special and unique.
And that's why you're back.
And that's why we're back.
It is a special place.
On your side in Lakeview, I'm Travers Mackle, WDSU News.
Well, after the storm, a new acronym entered our vocabulary, FEMA. And many accuse the agency of too much red tape and not enough action. WDSU dedicated weekly segments to help people work through their frustrations with FEMA for nearly 2 years. But since 2005, FEMA has doled out more than $5.1 billion to the New Orleans metro area, with another $3 billion still in the pipeline. The agency has now entered a new phase in the recovery, and joining me now is Tony Russell, the FEMA administrator for Louisiana, Arkansas, Oklahoma, New Mexico, and Texas. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Norm. Appreciate
that. All right. Memories still there. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Russell.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
All right. Pleasure's all ours.
Thank you.
As you know, in addition to FEMA, thousands of volunteers work to rebuild homes and lives. But as time passed, has Katrina fatigue set in? WDSU anchor Rachel Wolf checks in with three volunteer organizations that won't let this mission be forgotten.
Never ends, huh? Sweat equity to help the human race.
With temperatures soaring into the 100s, this church group soldiers on, still battling to help people return after Hurricane Katrina.
Today we're just working on putting interior doors in.
General contractor John Mueller oversees construction. He works with the St. Bernard Project.
We have anywhere between 20 and 30 volunteers per week.
Mueller and his wife moved here in 2007 from Florida to help the city rebuild.
It's been exciting. It's been frustrating.
They live in a travel trailer, working so New Orleanians can get out of their FEMA trailers. But not every volunteer has carpentry skills.
We're battling the hot New Orleans summertime elements out here. But we're getting it done.
For some, like these volunteers from Dallas, painting and landscaping are as good as it gets. Even that can make a huge difference, though, to someone who hasn't yet returned home.
You know, it's really putting that life, shattered life, back together, and for them to feel complete and whole again, I think it's psychologically very important that they get the flood line off of their house and the X off of their house.
Connie Udo heads up St. Paul's Homecoming Center. Last year it moved from Lakeview to Gentilly. Since then it's helped nearly 500 homeowners return.
You're presently unemployed?
Our center is still very active with case management and computer services, faxes. We still have a notary free once a week.
Udo says many of the people who still need help rebuilding have fallen through the cracks due to contractor fraud or road home complications. That's the case with Jack D.
Is that I have two torn rotator cuffs and I'm on Social Security disability with heart disease. I can't do what I could do 40 years ago.
Hundreds of St. Paul's volunteers gutted his house, then rewired and sheetrocked it.
I have never been exposed to this outpouring of charity and compassion. It just totally blew me away, and I'm forever in their debt.
But volunteer organizations don't always renovate homes. Sometimes they have to start from scratch. These 14 houses in the River Bend area were built from the ground up, and they will go to Habitat for Humanity families.
We were able to sponsor 7 homes fully.
A group called Rebuilding Hope in New Orleans, or RINO, coordinated volunteer efforts for the project. Director Kate Snyder says there's still good help out there.
For a lot of people, Katrina's over, and that's hard.
And that's why nonprofits are happy to have the volunteers that still come.
Because without them, this city would be a ghost town.
On your side in Orleans Parish, Rachel Wolf, WDSU News.
Great to see so many volunteers in late summer, typically the slowest time of year for these particular nonprofits. To find out how you can volunteer or donate to any of these groups, go to WDSU.com. Of course, one of the most haunting images in the days after Katrina, thousands of people stranded at the storm-damaged Superdome. It took 4 days for the National Guard to arrive and evacuate the people who sought shelter there. It was a similar scene of desperation at the Morial Convention Center. So how did these sites later become beacons of recovery? WDSU News anchor Scott Walker is on your side with the answer.
Life had just thrown us a major curveball and we weren't prepared for it.
5 years later, Doug Thornton vividly remembers the scene inside the Superdome in the days after Hurricane Katrina.
What I saw was just unbelievable. It was just a cesspool, a squalor, the worst conditions you can probably ever imagine.
The senior vice president for SMG, the company that manages the dome, slept in his dark office for days with mayhem unfolding around him.
I think everyone in New Orleans had serious doubts about everything. The Superdome, Saints, the city itself. We didn't know where to begin.
Back then, when there was talk of tearing down the Superdome, Thornton says it was tough to envision what the dome would be today.
Out of disaster sometimes comes opportunity, and this was our opportunity to actually make the Superdome a better place.
And on September 25th, 2006, the better place reopened.
Look out! Right through!
It was unbelievable. It was just an out-of-body experience, and I had tremendous pride like every New Orleanian that night, just proud to be back.
Stephen Perry, president and CEO of the New Orleans Convention and Visitors Bureau, is all about images and perception. The tourism industry that Perry fuels is the engine that drives the city, and Katrina flooded that engine.
We knew we were in serious trouble because you've got right on national television, international television, the two of the biggest icons, Superdome and the Convention Center, in states of destruction.
And people who had booked conventions quickly canceled.
In that first 90 days, we canceled nearly $3 billion of booked business.
To turn things around, Perry says the Superdome and Convention Center had to be fixed, and fast. The Convention Center reopened in June of 2006, 10 months after Katrina, with three conventions in a row.
They made the difference in taking that leap of faith to come back just really 2 or 3 weeks after we finished repairs. And that opened up that billion-dollar business again.
5 years later, Perry says the tourism and convention business in the city is at about 82% of the pre-Katrina levels, and he looks forward to brighter days.
Our biggest customers are back. This year, our leisure business is really back.
Thornton and Perry, who are longtime friends, believe the Saints have been a driving force in the city's recovery.
That maybe for the first time in American sports, a team put a city on its back and carried it.
The Superdome really was a powerful step forward in the rebuilding effort of New Orleans, and it was a reaffirmation that this city was going to make it.
On your side, Scott Walker, WDSU News.
As you know, Katrina inundated St. Bernard Parish with storm surge and forever changed that close-knit community. But as WDSU News reporter Heath Allen shows us, the parish is bouncing back with its trademark grit and determination.
No one could believe it. An entire parish under 10 to 20 feet of water. In just a matter of minutes, life changed forever in St. Bernard Parish.
It's going to start getting better, though. It really is. When we find these bodies, it's so sad. We all break down.
Shock, disbelief, anger all led to an immediate, fierce determination to come back, even before the water receded.
No question about that, brother. We're building this son of a bitch back, and we're going to be better than what we were.
The people of St. Bernard Parish are so resilient and so tenacious that nothing gets in their way.
5 years after Katrina literally sunk St. Bernard, much has changed. The population is growing. Many folks new to the parish. The business community, even in a struggling economy, has traction. The feel in the parish is good.
A hardworking, put your nose to the grindstone, and hey, let's just make sure that we're all moving in the right direction.
So every one of our buildings was either completely destroyed or just devastated beyond recognition.
5 years later, 10 schools open, all state-of-the-art, 5,400 students, and scores are up. Chalmette High School and the brand new ninth grade academy, a beacon to that failure is not an option attitude.
Any child who comes onto our campus from an academic perspective will have the finest there is to offer, from special needs children to average kids, to gifted and talented.
We're rebounding, I guess you'd say, from Katrina, and hopefully we can rebound a little quicker from this all spill than Katrina.
Talk about resilience. The business community, largely based on seafood, beat Katrina, took on the faltering economy, and now the oil spill.
As well as this parish has changed, we have changed. If you don't change, you get lost in times.
We're back in the parish, glad to be back. You know, we actually live in a better house than we had before the storm, so we're actually doing a little better, I think.
Like so many others, Johnny and Susie Melanson had to come back home to the parish. She fled Katrina with only her pictures.
I'm taking my pictures hella high water.
Well, you got both and your pictures.
That's right.
It is a much brighter picture for the Melansons 5 years after, and if home is where the heart is, here's the soul.
Now in the aftermath, we're building a body, and that is reaching people for the family of God, for the kingdom of God, and therein lies the greater miracle.
Katrina destroyed the buildings that made up First Baptist Chalmette, but not the heart. Pastor John D. Jeffries Church, rebuilt by volunteers from across America, rising from the rubble, a testament to faith.
Our mess became a miracle as well. We've seen God do some of the most miraculous things.
The Katrina Memorial at Shell Beach is a quiet reminder to what was lost 5 years ago. The resurgence of St. Bernard Parish, though, a pretty good glimpse at what's ahead. On your side in St. Bernard, Heath Allen, WDSU News.
It's been half a decade since Hurricane Katrina. Coming up, the good, the bad, and the ugly. We're on your side in the Lower Ninth Ward.
And
the thought of the Saints not being in New Orleans was something that, quite frankly, was unthinkable.
The man many people say saved the Saints opens up for the first time about keeping the black and gold in the Crescent City. You've seen the heartbreaking video, the dark hours and days after Hurricane Katrina made landfall, thousands of people rescued. WDSU News reporter Travis Mackle was on a police boat hours after the levees broke, and now he's reconnecting with those officers who are credited with saving hundreds of lives.
Yeah. The Hurricane Katrina pin over his name tag proves it. New Orleans police officer Brian Fleetwood stayed on the job when the storm hit. 5 years ago, Fleetwood was assigned to the juvenile division, but when the levees broke, he knew there was no kidding around.
Have you seen this video since the storm?
No, I haven't.
Along with a WDSU News photographer, I was able to jump on a police boat in the midst of the chaos when most of the city was underwater.
Once we got the boat launched, you could just hear people whistling from every direction.
The red and white awning! All right.
We got the axe.
Brian Fleetwood was on that boat, rescuing anyone and everyone he saw.
I think that first day when you saw us, that first day, I think we did maybe about 150 that day.
Fleetwood and his crew worked in Gentilly, near Elysian Fields and I-610. They were forced to launch the boat off an interstate on-ramp.
Every time I pass that area, I wonder, how did we do that, you know, with a 19-foot boat?
Detective Omar Diaz was also with Fleetwood on the boat. That's him with the life vest on. Diaz wore it for good reason.
Because I couldn't swim at the time.
The reason the officers targeted this area is because of Diaz, who grew up in this neighborhood.
We went out there to basically rescue my father.
And once they saved him,
all of a sudden we started hearing help, 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 and it was surprising to me how many people stayed behind.
All right, we're trying to knock down this thing right here.
In all, Fleetwood and Diaz, along with Officer Danny Scanlon with the axe, and Civil Sheriff Captain Phil Kitchen with the mustache, estimate they rescued more than 300 people.
You know, I thank God we were at that place at that time that we were able to do that. I don't consider myself a hero, if that's what you're saying.
We don't think of ourselves as heroes or anything. That's any police officer that would have did the same thing that we did if they would have had a boat.
This is what the area looks like now, in spots, still struggling to come back. And over there at that house, that's one of the spots where Fleetwood and Diaz saved lives.
5 years later, I still find myself going back to that place, and it's heartbreaking.
And while this area fights to come back, there are heartwarming stories.
I did run into somebody who recognized me. I was on Elysian Fields, was at lunchtime, and a guy came up to us and said, "You were the one that was in that boat. We were up in this apartment right up here, and y'all saved us. Y'all put us in a boat and brought us to the interstate."
Heroic efforts by two guys who say they were just doing their jobs. On your side in Gentilly, I'm Travers Mackle, WDSU News.
As my colleagues and I covered Katrina, many of us were also coping with disaster on a personal level. So just as we did 5 years ago, we wanted to give our viewers a glimpse into our lives now. Anchor Scott Walker has two rebuilding stories from the WDSU family.
WDSU reporter Heath Allen lived in St. Bernard Parish for 15 years. He never would have left. His wife and children were happy there. But for Heath and his family, like so many others, Katrina changed their plans.
And we always said it would take an act of God to get us out of that house. We had redone the whole house, one room at a time. Certainly liked St. Bernard Parish, certainly loved our neighbors. It was where we were.
This is where Heath lived until Hurricane Katrina, at the corner of Ohio and Despo Streets in Chalmette. 5 years later, this is what's left, an empty lot.
You look at pieces of your life. You look at pieces of your life that you don't have anymore, and it hits you two ways. It lets you know on one side that, you know, wait a minute, I was looking for that the other day, and I don't have it anymore, and that's where it went. And the other thing it tells you is just stuff, that you can replace your stuff, and stuff comes, stuff goes, and main thing is your family, and as long as they're good, you're good.
After Katrina, the Allens started a new chapter in Mandeville, and while they're a long way from where they were, they still feel right at home.
Well, you know, what's interesting is they call this St. Tammanard in some places, because a lot of people in St. Bernard Parish wound up on the North Shore.
Heath says he misses some parts of his old life.
I love to coach baseball, and I miss the kids that I coached in ball in St. Bernard Parish.
And 5 years later, looks back on Katrina and calls it a people bomb that blew up the fabric of his community.
People can go back, but the fabric isn't the same, because it's not the same people. And the people that you want to see are in Houston or Atlanta or just somewhere else.
A twin brother, Fletcher, he went home to my mother's house. She hasn't seen it yet.
For the mother of WDSU's Travers and Fletcher Mackle, it's been 5 years of rebuilding and moving on.
The way it looks, you just can't even imagine. I had a really pretty house.
Judy Mackle saw the Gentilly home she raised her sons in for the first time 20 days after the storm, right after the water finally receded.
There's nothing salvageable. I mean, there's nothing. I mean, this house looks awful, and it was such a nice house.
After the storm, Judy Mackle moved to Kenner. The house in Gentilly was finally bulldozed in late 2006.
I thought it was the best thing for me to do, and I needed to move on.
And now, after a desire to return to New Orleans, Judy lives in Lakeview, just a couple miles from where the Mackle's home of 35 years once stood.
Because I lived there for so many years, it was a very comfortable feeling to be back in the same area.
Judy still holds on to the memories of her old Gentilly home just two blocks from the London Avenue Canal and down Chatham Drive, where many of the homes here are still empty.
I'm sad when I see this.
She gets emotional walking through the now vacant lot, which she sold to her neighbor.
I do have a lifetime of memories, and when I do pass, it brings back great memories, sad memories, and great memories.
A few personal thoughts now as we conclude our report tonight. Although there is still much to be done in many key parts of the region, there is an overwhelming sense of encouragement and optimism that resonates loud and clear among the people. And there are two words that stand out in our travels and discussions with those we've met along this retrospective journey. Those words are spirit and unity, or simply put, a unity of spirit. Though some areas are no doubt immobilized by red tape and a lack of funds, overall there has been significant progress. Progress accomplished solely via the spirit and unity of the people who love their neighborhoods and are committed to bringing them back. We here at WDSU salute that commitment, and we'll be here to report the next chapter of this great region. Thanks for watching, and good night.